Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of Stranger in the Forest on Foot Across Borneo by Eric Hansen, narrated by Richard Poe. This book is copyrighted 1988 by Eric Hansen. This performance is copyrighted 1989 by Recorded Books Incorporated. Borneo, located in the Malay Archipelago, is the world's third largest island, and a little bigger than Texas. It's divided into four political regions. Sarawak State and Sabah State are Malaysian. Brunei is a British protectorate, and Kalimantan State, which covers 70% of the island, is part of Indonesia. In 1982, Eric Hansen decided to walk into the interior of Borneo. Armed with an Indonesian phrasebook and a 1945 map of the island, he entered the rainforest carrying only a bedsheet, a change of clothes, and a basket of trading goods. And now, Stranger in the Forest.
Prologue. Child's Play. When I was 8 years old, I found a piece of bamboo in my parents' garage. It was yellow with age and 5 feet long. It may have been an old rake handle, but from jungle movies on television, I knew what to do. With my pocket knife, I sharpened one end of the bamboo and made a spear. The house where my three sisters and I grew up stood on a corner lot separated from the street on two sides by a footpath and a hedge 5 feet high. The hedge was well trimmed and very dense, and sometimes I would wait behind it with my spear. When a neighborhood child was foolish enough to pedal by on a bicycle, I would stick the spear through the hedge and into the spokes of the front wheel. There was a cherry plum tree in the front yard, and when the fruit came into season, I crouched behind the hedge and fought one-sided battles with passing traffic and old people walking their dogs. Bicyclists and pedestrians learned to give our hedge a wide berth. My parents had planted a lawn and a beautiful flower garden behind the hedge. I remember the pink, yellow, and white poppies perched precariously on their slender, furry green stalks. There were tiger lilies and the orchids. People would bring my father orchids that wouldn't bloom, mostly cattleyas and cymbidiums. He doctored the plants back to health and kept them in an old bathtub in a shaded corner of the yard. The owners of the orchids sometimes came to see the blooms, but never asked for the plants back. Each year, the number of orchids and the variety of colors increased until the bathtub overflowed and a forest of potted orchids threatened to take over the backyard. Near the bathtub was a Gravenstein apple tree. It wasn't much for climbing, but the apples were good for pies and apple butter. The half-rotten apples on the lawn were used for spear practice. One afternoon, I grew tired of stabbing apples and directed my attention to a nearby camellia bush. Before my eyes, it transformed itself into a rhinoceros. I stood brave, then buried my spear in its leathery hide. Retrieving my weapon, I crouched like a hunter, motionless, listening, then crept silently into the front yard. My mother, preoccupied with an afternoon tea party, was oblivious to the wild animals lurking in her yard. I wrestled with a king cobra garden hose and left it with a broken back. A bear and a lion were soon dispatched, and for each new victory I cut a notch in the spear shaft. I became excited and began running around the house faster and faster, spearing everything in sight. There was a terrible loss of life. Suddenly, a huge bull elephant reared up in my path and trumpeted a frightful challenge. I knew from the National Geographic magazine stacked next to the toilet that I was a goner if I missed the one vulnerable spot near the elephant's temple. I took aim and with all my strength threw the bamboo spear, clean through the bush that obscured the big living room window. The sounds of breaking glass and overturned teacups were followed by startled screams. That brought me out of the jungle fast, but only momentarily. The next thing I knew, I was being chased by natives, hundreds of them, all with spears, and so I ran for my life. Down the empty street I went, dodging between parked cars until I finally gave them the slip and hid in a neighbor's basement, until eventually I had to go home to dinner. That night my mother listened as I explained about the jungle and the animals and the spear. My mother understood my hunting fantasies and excused the spear incident, because it was she who would sit on the edge of my bed most nights and read to me from Kipling's Jungle Book. It wasn't until 25 years later in the Sarawak rainforest that I learned about real spears and what it feels like to look at the receiving end of one when it is held in the hands of an expert. Chapter 1. Prelude to a Journey. Christmas with Mr. Das. In August 1976, I was faced with a simple choice: to fly directly from Jakarta to Singapore, or to go to Singapore by way of Kuching, Sarawak, on the island of Borneo. I had never heard of Kuching, but was told that from there I might catch the MV Perak, a 30-year-old, 211-foot-long Borneo trader that cruised the South China Sea between Kuching and Singapore. 4 first-class staterooms, some traveler had told me long before, white enameled walls, polished mahogany furniture, crisp bed linen, and caged ceiling fans. Somerset Maugham stuff. I had listened to his description of meals with uniformed Malay officers, of tattooed Dayak stevedores swarming the decks, and of a white-haired Chinese steward who announced morning tea at sunrise by running his knuckles gently down the hardwood louvers of the cabin door. It had sounded too good. For the extra $10, I decided to go by way of Kuching. An easy decision, but one that would, 6 years later, totally transform my life. I was traveling at that time with my friend Robin, an Australian from Brisbane, Queensland. She had never been out of Australia before, and this trip was her introduction to Asia. We arrived in Kuching on the weekly flight from Jakarta, having changed planes in Pontianak, West Kalimantan. From the tiny airport shed, it was just a short bus ride into town. A warm tropical rain sprinkled the muddy Kuching River as the tambangs, the distinctive double-oared river taxis, crisscrossed the main current, picking their way through huge nipa palms and other debris that had swept downstream. Morning shoppers in search of fish and meat and vegetables wandered through the covered markets that were conveniently perched along the riverbank. At day's end, much of the refuse from the markets was thrown into the brown current. Across the street from the markets was a row of shop fronts typical of Anglo-Malay colonial architecture. These 2 to 3-storied stuccoed brick buildings enclosed a walkway a block long that opened onto the street through a series of wide archways. Within these shaded archways hung plastic buckets, carry bags, and children's toys. The cool passageway was packed as quiet, milling crowds bargained with vendors over cooking pots and bicycles, sacks of rice, and dried bêche de mer. The street itself had that distinctive Southeast Asian smell of dried fermented prawns and sump oil. The acrid fumes stung my nose at first, but I found them pleasant. Chattering swiftlets darted through the shopping arcade as lumbering blue and white buses nudged through the pedestrians and traffic. Rising above this morning scene was the golden dome of the Great Mosque. On a hill commanding a strategic bend on the river was Fort Margarita, with its whitewashed battlements. Just upriver was the Istana, the former residence of the White Rajas. 3 generations of benevolent rule by James Brooke and his successors, Charles and Viner Brooke, had come to an abrupt end with the Japanese invasion of Kuching in 1941. The rain began to come down in sheets, and Robin and I ducked into a coffee shop across from the main wharf area. A man bicycled past with what appeared to be a machete placed in the wicker basket attached to the handlebars. The man, cheerfully oblivious to the downpour, was drenched, and his arms and legs were covered with glistening blue-black floral tattoos. He also had distended earlobes. A transistor radio hidden from sight in the bicycle basket was playing the Beach Boys' Surfin' USA. I was beginning to like Kuching. The machete, I later learned, is called a parang, and is the universal tool of the people of the upriver communities. It is modeled after the traditional headhunting swords. The rain cleared, and we started walking. A few blood-warm droplets continued to fall as we made our way down India Street, past curry houses and fabric shops. There were fruit and ice cream vendors on bicycles ringing their bells, but they would attract few customers until midday. On one corner, a man with waist-length matted black hair was selling amulets. His neck was strung with bits of multicolored paper packets and brass and silver containers. Men of the motorcycle helmet, necktie, and polyester trouser cult were handing over $1 each for a thumbnail-sized piece of bark, which the amulet man tied to their biceps with a length of colored cloth. Thus armed, the men climbed onto their motorcycles and disappeared into the light morning traffic. After leaving our bags in the hotel, we found the local agent for the Straits Steamship Company Limited. From behind a desk stacked with yellow files, the man informed us that the MV Perak was indeed still operating, and yes, there was a stateroom available. The ship was scheduled to leave Kuching in 11 days. We bought the tickets, and that afternoon visited the fabulous Sarawak Museum. Out of general interest, we had been collecting giant beetles and other bugs on peninsular Malaysia a few months earlier. So when we saw the insects on display, our interest in the interior of Sarawak was immediately aroused. Then, on the second floor of the museum, we found a full-sized walk-in mock-up of a longhouse room on display. All the domestic items were in place: the rice pots, the spears, the rice wine jars, and the human skulls. After a short discussion with a member of the museum staff and a glance through the airport tourist literature, we decided to go upriver to visit a real longhouse. No more thought went into our plans, and, like most extraordinary journeys, this one was completely innocent and spontaneous. No one could have foreseen what followed. 2 days later, the river trader Ovaltine Super Express deposited us a couple of 100 miles up the Rajang River at the Kapit Wharf. The first thing we encountered was a 16-foot-long crocodile stretched out on its back on the raised walkway that surrounds the central square of this upriver trading post. There was a very large bullet hole through the crocodile's head, and its yellow belly scales were as large as bathroom tiles. Mr. Das was watching us. He was seated at a table 20 feet from where we stood, gaping at the former river monster. He waved us over to join him for tea. Mr. Das was dressed in a pair of freshly pressed blue slacks and pink rubber bathroom thongs. His white shirt was open at the neck, revealing a tattooed garden of stars and flowers. He wore a gold wristwatch, and a black fountain pen with gold clips stood by in his shirt pocket. Tea arrived, and I asked Mr. Das if he was afraid of crocodiles.
"No," he replied. "I'm safe from crocodile."
He pulled up his trouser leg to display a large tattoo of a hook on his ankle.
"We Iban catch the crocodile with hook tied to bamboo raft. When crocodile see this hook, no bite."
"What a good idea," I replied, wondering if I could have a facsimile drawn on my ankle with a laundry marker. "And did Mr. Das know any interesting longhouse for us to visit?"
"Yes, you come with me," he replied immediately.
Mr. Das was returning to his Iban village in the interior after 2 years of work on an oil drilling platform off the coast of Brunei. We left the crocodile to the men with sharp knives and strong stomachs, and with Mr. Das leading, we went shopping for the journey.
"Tobacco," said Mr. Das.
We bought tobacco.
"Sugar,"
he continued, and the Chinese shopkeeper smiled. We bought enough tinned food to last our anticipated 2-day visit. When the essential shopping was finished, I asked what special gifts might be appreciated. Mr. Das led me to a nondescript door on a passageway behind the main bazaar. I knocked. The door opened to reveal an old Chinese man dressed in striped pajamas.
"Arak,"
I said, following Mr. Das's instructions. The man half shut the door and disappeared. A minute later, he returned with an old brown beer bottle filled with an unidentifiable liquid. Without handing me the bottle so I could inspect the contents, the man delivered his sales pitch.
"One bottle, enough 4 men. Maybe 1 bottle, enough 6 men.
No walk."
He glanced up and down the laneway.
$1, $5.
I bought 5 bottles at $4 a bottle, and with our new friend, Robin and I climbed aboard the late afternoon river trader. This elongated diesel version of the African Queen took us upstream to the jungle trading post where the Bale River flows into the Rajang. There, the big trees began to dominate the river, and I had the sensation that this was the gateway to the great forests of the Iban homelands that I had read about in Vanishing World by Hedda Morrison, Lee Wright, and K.F. Wong. We hopped ashore and hitched a ride in a dugout canoe powered by a 20-horsepower Johnson outboard motor. The journey took about 2 hours, and we arrived at the gravel beach below Mr. Doss's longhouse just before nightfall. The longhouse was 200 feet long. Sections of the roof could be propped open from the inside to let out smoke from the cooking fires and to admit light. A row of evenly spaced identical doors opened onto a 40-foot-wide springy bamboo slat veranda that overlooked the river. Behind the doors were the private family quarters for cooking, eating, storage, and sleeping. The entire structure was built off the ground on 8 to 10 foot tall hardwood posts to facilitate cooling and ventilation. There were other functions of this raised design. Traditionally, everything that Westerners would put in the garbage can or down the sink or toilet would be disposed of by sliding a floorboard aside, then bombs away. Pigs, chickens, and dogs roamed and scavenged the underworld of the longhouse, keeping it relatively clean. The longhouses were originally built on stilts for defense, and the slippery, notched pole ladders at either end of the common veranda could be pulled up quickly in times of danger. Building off the ground also provided protection from snakes and leeches, as well as from the voracious bacterial fungi that inhabit the jungle floor. Any structure built on the ground would be consumed by microorganisms in a very short time. We sat down on the veranda. The longhouse seemed deserted. Only a few children and dogs were in sight. Mr. Doss disappeared into one of the doors and returned a few minutes later to announce that everyone had gone to another longhouse. The last longboat would be leaving soon, and there was room for us. But this had been an exhausting day, and I wasn't sure I wanted to go anywhere. I asked Mr. Doss what was happening at the other longhouse. "We go to celebrate Christmas," he replied. "Christmas in August? How could we refuse?" The jungle was very dark as we felt our way down the muddy riverbank and into a smaller dugout canoe. 4 men had joined us. No one had a flashlight, and as the men paddled downstream, rocks and giant snags began to appear. They loomed up beside the dugout without warning and then disappeared back into the darkness. I couldn't see anything beyond 5 feet, and when we arrived at the second longhouse 20 minutes later, the dugout was half full of water. There were at least 200 people gathered on the big common porch. Most of them appeared to be drunk. We were introduced to the headman and his wife. Our hostess was fat and formidable. She was also bare-breasted and covered with sweat from the dinner preparations over an open fire. Her breasts looked like giant greased brown papayas. She smiled at us and broke out in a hearty laugh. Everyone seemed friendly enough, but we didn't speak a word of Malay or Iban and had to depend on Mr. Das for translations. When we sat down, an Iban pua blanket was laid out in front of us. A dozen or so small dishes of food were placed on the blanket, and Mr. Das showed me how to arrange the offering. The eggs, glutinous rice, popcorn, salt, feathers, and fried bananas were auspiciously rearranged to everyone's satisfaction. Then I was handed a live rooster. What do I do, Mr. Das?
Hit everyone on the head, came his emphatic reply.
I'm just a visitor, I tried to explain. I can't.
But the headman's wife was coming for me. She pulled me to my feet and nudged me towards the seated throng. I was uncertain what to do, but people bowed down as I approached, so I tentatively tapped a few heads with the struggling rooster. The idea was to bestow a blessing.
"Harumph!" scoffed Big Mama.
She grabbed the rooster by the legs and began beating people over the head as if she were swatting tennis balls. She waded into the seated crowd, thrashing left and right with sizzling backhands, overhead smashes, and brilliant volleys. The frantic squawk soon subsided, and after this brief demonstration, she shoved the half-dead rooster back into my hands.
"That's how we do it in Texas," or the Iban equivalent, she seemed to say with a look of disdain.
I beat heads with a limp rooster for a few minutes, and everyone seemed to enjoy that. When I finished with the blessing, I handed the bird to a man nearby as if he were a golf caddy. Then I sat down on the floor mat next to Mr. Doss. Soon, Big Mama and the caddy were rolling about the porch wrestling for possession of the rooster. The man ended up with the body, and Big Mama came up with the head, which she proceeded to rub in the man's face.
She was strong, and the man couldn't escape her grip.
A party joke, explained Mr. Das.
What's going on? Asked Robin. I was beginning to feel uneasy, but also slightly amused.
Minum la! Minum la!
Drink, drink, ordered our hosts, and so we drank. Too much. Our glasses were continually filled, and soon I began to feel quite relaxed. A young Iban girl knelt directly in front of me and fixed me with a sweet gaze. She also set two large glasses at my feet. One full of tuak, rice wine, the other of arak, rough distilled spirits. She then began to sing a haunting Iban song. Mr. Das explained that it was a song of welcome, and that when the song was finished, I would honor the girl by drinking both glasses at a single go. That was impossible. I was already very drunk, and as the song progressed, I began to perspire with nervousness. I didn't want to offend anyone, but what were the alternatives? Before the song was finished, a man crept up behind the singer and pulled her over backwards, smothering her face with two handfuls of pot black mixed with sump oil. When she sat up, her pretty face was completely covered with black muck. The song hadn't been finished, so I didn't have to drink. I asked Mr. Das if the girl was upset over the incident.
Oh, no, he replied. It is only for fun. She was lucky. Sometimes we use pig shit in pot black.
The evening was clearly getting out of control, and by midnight Robin was gripping my arm tightly. We watched as a man called out for food. In response, a charred leg of wild pig was thrown across the porch and hit him square in the chest. To my left, I saw a young man of no more than 16 leap onto a woman in her 70s and force her onto her back. Fully clothed, he humped her two or three times before rolling off. Everyone roared with laughter, including the woman.
Party joke? I asked Mr. Das, hopefully.
I glanced at my pretty, strawberry-blonde, fair-skinned friend and felt a slight shudder of apprehension.
Great Christmas party, I whispered to her, laughing.
Christmas, as it turned out, was Mr. Das's English translation for Gawai Antu, the Iban tribute to the departed spirits. In simple terms, this party was to mark the end of mourning for anyone whose relative had died in the previous 6 months. Dietary and other restrictions had been observed by the mourners. One man had not cut his hair from the day his wife had died, and that evening he sat in the middle of the crowd and wept publicly for his wife. His hair was then cut off. The headman collected donations for a poor old widow, and another woman was allowed to use soap for the first time in 4 months. The subtleties of the rituals were beyond my understanding, but as the evening wore on, I became enchanted by the Iban sense of fun. The night blossomed into a series of ludicrous and bizarre scenes. The drinking continued, and a man went berserk. He punched two men before being restrained by five others. 10 feet from where we sat, he was tied to a post with jungle vines. They left him to kick and scream, and he exhausted himself in about 15 minutes. No one took any notice, and half an hour later he was sitting peacefully at the base of the post. A man then approached him to see if he had calmed down, and after a short, whispered conversation, he was untied. The man who had gone berserk joined the party as if nothing unusual had happened. He was fine for the rest of the evening. By this time, my confused and arak-sodden companion had been escorted to the headman's room by a sympathetic older woman. Mr. Das assured me she would be safe. And anyway, I was beginning to enjoy myself. What a delightful bunch of maniacs I had discovered. 3 a.m. arrived, and no end to the party was in sight. One man passed out, and his friends propped him up and poured more rice wine down his throat to revive him. The festivities continued to heat up. Men were now indiscriminately firing guns into the jungle night and screaming. Men, women, and children were getting sick over the railings. Then the longhouse caught fire. Something was burning beneath the bamboo slat floor. There was a lot of smoke, and everyone laughed. Tuak was poured onto the flames, but to no effect. A vomiting man was directed to the spot, but that didn't help either. Buckets of water were sent for, and I watched a man who imagined his penis was a fire hose set to work on the spreading flames. The fire was soon put out, and the party continued.
In stages, I let down my defenses, and finally, when the people realized I was willing to join the insanity, the party really took off for me. I thought I had been to wild parties, but nothing before or since has come close to what I experienced that evening. I remember Big Mama pinning me to the floor with one knee on my chest as she rubbed the clammy rooster head in my face. Party joke, I told myself. A group of us grabbed the big cooking pots, empty, from the kitchen area and set upon people too drunk to defend themselves. They were held down by many hands as the pot black was ground into their clothing. Sometime later, in my Arak-inspired state, I heard, or at least thought I heard, a scream of terror coming from the headman's room. I suddenly remembered my mate. "Where's Robin?" I mumbled. "Must find Robin." I staggered to my feet and in the darkness bounded down the longhouse bamboo porch as far as the first clothesline. "Gnar!" The wire caught me at neck level and laid me out cold. I came 2 hours later, nauseated and shivering in the thick jungle mist. The pre-dawn light revealed a silent, body-strewn veranda. Guns, broken dishes, animal bones, charred floorboards, and an overturned rice wine jar littered the scene as chickens and dogs picked over the remains. Now that's what I call a party. I got to my feet. Mr. Das, where are you? I called out weakly, but there was no response. I found Robin dozing safely in bed, and I climbed in next to her, reeking of arak and pig fat. "What happened last night?" she muttered in a half-sleep. "Are you all right? The shooting and yelling. I was afraid." "Not now," I moaned, then fell asleep. We had been in Sarawak 4 days. We returned to Kapit, and there I met upriver agent Jimmy Singh. He informed me that he had been a border patrol scout during the 1960s confrontation with Indonesia and had been up every major river in the 7th Division. He knew the country and he had maps. One rainy night after a dinner of fried noodles at the Kapit Hotel, he told me the story of a lush highland valley where there was an open border area between Sarawak and Kalimantan. The Apo Kayan, Kenya country, he said, indicating the approximate location on the map. According to Jimmy Singh, the highland climate was cool, the people were hospitable, and most important, they still observed adat, traditional law. The people also grew giant pineapples and owned the best hunting dogs and antique porcelain rice wine jars on the island. Jimmy Singh mentioned that the area was beyond government control and that a passport wouldn't be necessary. My ears pricked up at that. I had worked and traveled in the Middle East and Asia for 5 years, and the thought of visiting a place untouched by Western visitors filled me with excitement. It is every traveler's dream to find an undiscovered area, and as I listened to Jimmy Singh's stories, I convinced myself that this was the place. There was no mention of the hill logging industry that was just beginning, the cult of the Holy Ghost, or the hydroelectric schemes that were to create the major social and political issues of the 1980s. A week later, Robin and I boarded the MV Perak and steamed down the Kuching River, bound for Singapore. Steward Boon Kok Peng stowed our bottles of tonic water and Bombay gin in the galley refrigerator in preparation for the languid 3-day crossing of the South China Sea. The welt on my neck gradually faded, and during the voyage I realized I had fallen in love with Sarawak. 100 years of benevolent rule by the white rajahs showed in the character of the people. The harmonious mix of Malay, Chinese, Indian, and indigenous tribal people from the interior gave the country an easygoing, relaxed feel. Walking down a street in Kuching was like walking back to a forgotten era or into a dream. The waterfront in Chinese and Indian sections of Kuching had retained their 1920s colonial appearance, and as soon as I traveled up my first jungle river, winding its way into the rainforest, I felt as if I had returned to one of my childhood jungle fantasies. On day 2 of the voyage, I glanced overboard in an attempt to gauge our progress in relation to the banded sea snakes that seemed to be keeping pace with the boat. The shallow draft MV Perak rolled heavily in the inky blue swell as flying fish hurried on their way. The aroma of smoked raw rubber and coconut oil permeated the first-class cabins, where we sat sipping afternoon tea beneath a raucous, oscillating fan. We were both silent. Robin read a book, and I thought about our visit to Sarawak. During our stay, I had a familiar sensation in my stomach, the one we all get when we return to a familiar and loved place. I felt as though I had come home. If a 2-week visit was so full of wonderfully strange events, what would it be like to live in Sarawak? I wanted to find out, and I made the decision to return. I didn't know when, but I knew I would come back to search for that highland valley. Chapter 2. A Little Preparation. Sarawak, 1982. The deafening roar and vibration of the twin 500-horsepower Detroit diesel engine suddenly ceased, and at idle, the 60-foot aluminum-hulled express launch began to drift to a standstill. It nudged the floating log dock below the main market square of Marudi and nestled in with half a dozen similar boats. From the air, they might have looked like a string of giant silver fish, bows facing upriver in the slow-moving, muddy current. By mid-morning, the Baram River was already dotted with a wide assortment of rivercraft. Tugboats were hauling massive log rafts from the interior to the downstream timber mills, and at the main wharf, black-and-white battered coastal tramp freighters with lines of rust running from the scuppers to the waterline were being unloaded. I watched as a cloud of blue-gray smoke erupted from an ancient deck crane on one of the boats. Gears gnashed and steel cables groaned under the weight of wooden pallets loaded with tin goods and compact Japanese cars. Stevedores struggled across the splintery wood jetty, wheeling gigantic sacks of rice and cement. 4-foot-long cylindrical pig baskets woven of rattan were being lifted from the hold of one ship. The basket swung through the air, and the pigs squealed in terror before being stacked 5 deep in the back of a decrepit motor lorry. Handsomely constructed longboats and simple dugout canoes jostled for space between the boats to unload their cargoes of rattan and freshly killed wild game. I walked up the wooden ramp from the dock and crossed the street to a cafe facing the river. I selected a chair at an empty table and ordered kopi susu, the Malay version of café au lait, strong black coffee mixed with sweetened condensed milk. From where I sat at the circular, marble-topped hardwood table, I had a view of the river traffic and the main bazaar area, which was enclosed on 3 sides by 2-story arcaded shopfronts. Projecting from the peeling facades of these buildings were faded canvas awnings bearing advertisements for an assortment of products. My imagination was set to work by Great Wall Canned Chicken Claws, Skyscraper Filter Cigarettes, Masculine Pills for Men, and Medicated Brill Cream. The variety of rivercraft reflected the racial diversity of the people moving through Marudi's central market square. 4 major tribal groups, Iban, Kilabit, Kayan, and Penan, come to Marudi to do business with the Chinese, Malay, and Indian merchants. Marudi is the farthest upriver major trading post and services all the longhouses in the Tuto, Tinjar, and Baram river basins. These modest shops also attract people from the central highlands, hundreds of miles away across trackless rainforest. Borneo is the 3rd largest island in the world. It is approximately 800 miles by 600 miles and straddles the equator. Nearly 80% of the island is covered in steaming tropical rainforest, filled with valuable species of hardwood and inaccessible mineral deposits, including gold, diamonds, uranium, and coal. Until the late 1970s, the exploitation of the interior was limited because oil and timber, the major natural resources, were readily obtainable near the coast. The jungle appears lush at first glance, but the ground is infertile because of the heat and the constant leaching of the soil by the daily rain. The plants and trees receive nutrients by recycling their own leaves and rotting vegetation. 6 great rivers drain the island, and at the headwaters of these rivers, the central highlands of Kalimantan are isolated from the coast by huge sets of rapids. The confusion of mountain ridges that rise to 13,000 feet is divided by smaller rivers that flow in all directions. To the north, facing the South China Sea, the tiny, oil-rich sultanate of Brunei is wedged between the East Malaysian states of Sarawak and Sabah. Kalimantan, which occupies the southern two-thirds of the island, is claimed by Indonesia. The people of the interior are classified as Proto-Malays and Deutero-Malays, and are divided into at least 12 distinct tribal groupings, including Iban, Murut, Melinau, Bidayu, Kenya, Kayan, Kelabit, and Penan. The men are about 5.5 feet tall, and the women are an inch or two shorter. They have light brown skin and straight black hair. Traditionally, both men and women distend their earlobes with brass weights for beauty and practice extensive body tattooing. For the longhouse people, the staple diet is hill rice, which is cultivated with slash-and-burn, long-fallow farming techniques. There are still bands of nomadic hunters and gatherers who wander through the rainforest in groups of 25 to 35 to hunt wild pigs and search for sago palms, Eugisonia utilis, from which they extract their staple food, sago flour. These forest nomads, commonly referred to as Penan, are considered to be the jungle experts by all the inland tribes. Because they live in the shade of the forest, their skin is very fair. They have a great affection for the coolness of the forest, and until the 1960s would not come out into the open even for 5 minutes. For them, sunlight is extremely unpleasant. They are broad and much more stocky than the river people. The Penan are extremely shy and have had little contact with the outside world. Most of their trade is conducted with remote Kayan, Kenya, and Kelabit longhouse communities on the edge of the rainforest. An observer seeing me at that riverside cafe might have concluded that I was absorbed in the waterfront activities before me, but I was actually trying to unravel the sequence of events that had brought me to this place. 6 years had passed since the Christmas party with Mr. Das, yet the events of that evening were still unusually clear to me. Upon my return to the United States from what became a 3-year journey through Southeast Asia, I attempted to settle in San Francisco, but I continued to fantasize about Jimmy Singh's vague account of an isolated highland community. The allure of Borneo grew in stages. One of the principal attractions of the central highlands of Kalimantan was its inaccessibility. I found the blank spots on the maps irresistible. Of the many places I had visited in the Middle East and Asia between 1971 and 1978, Sarawak was the one area that I felt might have escaped the standard Western influences. Tourists, missionaries, the Peace Corps, Marine Corps, and U.S. aid. A quiet little backwater that existed in a British colonial twilight was what I had in mind. My assumptions reveal only how hopelessly ignorant I was of the actual situation in Sarawak and Kalimantan in the 1980s. In 1973, a fanatical Christian revival had ripped through the longhouse communities in Sarawak. The profound effects of that revival were still in evidence in 1982. In some villages, people went to church 3 times daily, and drinking and dancing were forbidden. Priceless family heirlooms, such as dream beads, charms, and old headhunting swords, were thrown in the rivers or burned because of their magical power to cure sickness and control weather or to bring good luck on the hunt. Special beads were used to interpret dreams and divine the future. These objects are an indispensable part of animist beliefs and wholly incompatible with modern Christian teachings. In 1979, hardwood log prices doubled on the world market, and timber extraction from Sarawak increased dramatically, with Japan, Korea, and the United States providing the market. The local people provided cheap labor. By 1982, when I was contemplating that colonial twilight, the timber industry in Sarawak was exporting $583 million worth of logs and milled lumber annually. A similar scenario had developed in East Kalimantan. Over the previous decade, timber extraction in that area increased by 50 times in volume and nearly 9,000 times in value. These timber operations in East Kalimantan have grown to represent approximately 50% of the total of Indonesian timber exports, Not bad, considering only 1% of the population of Indonesia lives in the area. I was blissfully unaware that these things were happening as I organized my trip. I had the good fortune of being able to make my plans in near-perfect ignorance of my destination. From 1978 through 1982, I fed my Borneo fantasy with regular visits to the libraries of the University of California at Berkeley, where I had once been a student of industrial art and environmental design. One day, while I browsed through the stacks, I happened upon a complete collection of Sarawak Museum journals from 1912 onwards. Everything one would like to know about Sarawak is contained in those 35 wonderful volumes. In one of the papers submitted by Herbert and Patricia Whittier, the Apo Kayan area of East Kalimantan, two themes stood out: migration and trade. The Whittiers included with their article a small map detailing the traditional trade routes from the highlands to the coast, and a brief mention was made of desirable trade items. This obscure reference, combined with a map of British paratrooper Tom Harrison's 1945 route through the highlands and Jimmy Singh's stories, gave birth to my unlikely journey. Using these three sources of information, I linked together a pathway over the spinal range of mountains that divides Borneo northeast to southwest. In the library, the pencil line that I effortlessly drew across the map connecting villages and traversing mighty mountains looked promising. It was not until I stood at the very edge of the Sarawak rainforest that I discovered most of the trails no longer existed, and many of the longhouses were abandoned. It was then I also realized I had no idea what I was doing. The aim of the trip was to cross the island, following old trade routes, collecting jungle products and medicinal plants of value, and exchanging these and Western goods for what I needed. The concept was a masterful piece of scholarly lunacy based on anachronistic information and my own half-baked notions of Sarawak that had been gleaned from a 12-day drunken visit 6 years earlier. I was to learn later that Jimmy Singh had never been to the highlands, and that there was an open border between Sarawak and Kalimantan for a very simple reason. It was almost impossible to move through that uninhabited, wild, jungle-clad mountain country. A passport wasn't necessary because there was no one to look at it. I anticipated the lost world of Arthur Conan Doyle, and in doing so I made a thorough job of setting myself up for some breathtaking surprises in the jungle when it had long become too late to turn back. I must have been sitting at the Maruti waterfront cafe staring into space for some time, because I was suddenly startled by a voice nearby. It was the Chinese proprietor, asking me in English if I would like something more to drink. "Yes, I'll have an iced lemon tea, please," I told him. The man nodded and shuffled away. A light rain was falling on the river, but it gave no relief from the hot, damp air that was being nudged around the room by the wooden blades of an overhead fan. My drink arrived in a tall, frosty glass packed with ice, and I took a long sip. I wasn't ready to search for a hotel room, so I occupied my thoughts by reviewing the setbacks and mistakes that had led up to my present effort to enter the rainforest from Maruti. I winced at the thought of my incredible naivete when I stepped off the plane in Kuching Airport 2 months earlier. The first mistake I had made upon my return to Sarawak was to take a nostalgic trip up the Rajang and Balai rivers in search of Mr. Das's longhouse. I didn't expect to see Mr. Das, but I anticipated that a few days spent at the scene of the Christmas party would put me in the right frame of mind for my journey to the highlands. I caught an express boat to the Cebu and then continued up the Rajang River to the riverside town of Kapit. Kapit had not changed appreciably in the 6 years since I had last seen it. The shop seemed to have a wider range of goods, and the local Iban youths had discovered jogging shorts and Adidas warm-up suits. I spent the night in a small hotel and left early next morning for the Balai River. A cool mist hung over the river and diffused the sunlight as we motored upstream. The sleek new riverboat was built of metal, very different from the original wooden-hulled launch that I remembered from my first visit. Piled on the roof of the riverboat were rolls of linoleum and cheap living room furniture, upholstered in bright orange vinyl. Wedged between sacks of rice was a television set bolted to the top of a small gasoline-powered Honda generator. I noticed that the longhouse roofs were now covered with corrugated metal rather than the traditional atop thatch. At least the Iban passengers on the riverboat lived up to my exotic memories. The men carried the jungle knives and woven rattan backpacks, and between the men and women there were more than enough tattoos and brass earweights to occupy a bevy of National Geographic photographers. Without introducing myself, I took a few photos and then smiled to mask my discomfort. I didn't speak any Iban, and my Malay was then so poor that I was unable to understand their comments. I was still blinded by my Sarawak Museum Journal fantasies, but the setting I found myself in was pretty impressive. White man travels slowly upriver in Chinese river trader. All the appropriate props were in place. The brown-skinned natives, the spears, the woven leaf sun hats, and the acrid-smelling cheroot in every mouth. And outside, the heart of darkness slipped by. What a starry-eyed fool I must have seemed to those people. They were simply returning from a shopping trip to Kapit Bazaar, the only market within 50 miles. I couldn't remember the name of Mr. Das's longhouse, but the memory of those 2 days recovering from Gawai Antu had become branded in my mind, and I felt sure I would recognize it. Periodically, the Chinese helmsman would run the bow of the boat into the slick, muddy riverbank. He held the boat steady in the current while individuals or small groups gathered their belongings. The angle of the bow was specially designed to match the slope of the riverbank. From the wide, flat foredeck, it was an easy step ashore. The people would struggle up the mud slope and disappear into the forest. The engines would be thrown into reverse, and with a loud sucking sound, the boat would pull free from the mud. We continued upstream, and I found myself dreaming about my first visit to this beautiful river. The Arak, the rooster head, even the clothesline. Within a couple of hours of leaving Kapit, I realized we must be getting close to Mr. Das's longhouse. Log rafts were lining the banks, but eventually I recognized a distinctive turn in the river where a tall rock cliff stood at the water's edge. The realization that I had been to this same spot before sent a shudder of excitement through my body. The longhouse would be around the next bend on the right-hand side of the river. I pulled my bag onto the foredeck and waited excitedly in the fresh air. I visualized the scene. Children swimming in the shallows, and the longboats pulled up on the banks, the longhouse itself obscured by the wild tangle of lush jungle, but identified by dozens of roosters crowing. The riverboat churned around the last bend, and my eyes came to rest on a gigantic log-loading station. I was stunned, disbelieving the evidence of change my eyes were registering. Tugboats stood by as barges of Singapore registry were being piled high with hardwood logs. Bulldozers and huge lumber trucks moved back and forth over the large clearing, arranging the giant logs. The barren ground was soaked with sump oil to keep down the dust, and raw, red-earth logging roads radiated into the denuded hillsides. The longhouse was nowhere in sight. I felt as though I had returned to my childhood home, only to find it replaced by an auto-wrecking yard. What a stupid idea it was to come back. I should never have returned to this river, I told myself. Memories of my wonderfully innocent first visit to Sarawak were shattered in an instant by this scene of devastation. For the first time, I began to realize that the obscene greed and short-sightedness of the logging industry in Sarawak was ruining the forest. The boat eased next to the log landing stage and unloaded boxes of engine parts and soft drinks. I didn't bother getting off the riverboat to find out what had happened to all my mad friends. I assumed they were employed as chainsaw operators or truck drivers. I stood on the bow with my bag, and above the roar of the engine, the helmsman yelled for me to jump ashore. I told him I would take the round trip and return to Kapit. 6 years had been too long to wait. With increasing feelings of uncertainty, I was wondering if the country had been turned into one big timber concession. Back in Kapit, I looked up Jimmy Singh. He greeted me cordially, though I doubted he could remember me. We sat in a coffee shop, drinking lukewarm Carlsberg beer, while I explained my plans. Jimmy proudly announced that he had gone into the tourist business and would love to help me get upriver.
For an old friend, a special price. Boat, guides, food, gasoline, gifts, and tobacco for 1 week, $2,400 Malay dollars. The equivalent of about 1,000 U.S. dollars. I laughed at his joke. Jimmy smiled. He wasn't kidding, and he wouldn't lower his price. Since my first visit, large numbers of tourists had discovered Kapit as the gateway to the Iban longhouse experience. I was being treated like your standard 30 to 45 day mail order catalog adventure traveler. After more talk and beer, Jimmy eventually confessed that he had, well, never actually been to the highland communities that he had so colorfully described to me years earlier. But he tried to assure me the area did exist. He had heard the stories himself. I ended up paying for the drinks and decided that I would have to find my own way. I would move farther inland, and perhaps there I would find the jungle of my library fantasies. For the next 8 weeks, I struggled up one river after another, trying to reach the big mountains that separate Sarawak and Kalimantan. I got close on three occasions, but something different stopped me each time. On my first attempt, I traveled up the Balay River as far as Ruma in Tawau, a distance of about 70 miles, which took me 2 days. From there, I couldn't find guides, and I hadn't brought enough longboat gasoline to reach Long Singut, the Kenya village located another 75 to 80 miles upriver, near the headwaters, and within a 3 to 5 day walk to the first village in Kalimantan. The extra gasoline was necessary to get to Long Singut and back to Ruma in Tawau. I was disappointed by this first setback, but I had expected some initial problems. The upper Balay River had been beautiful, and I had the opportunity to practice Malay for 4 days. Still full of optimism, I told myself I must be on the wrong river. It was a simple matter of finding the correct river. Everything would be fine, or so my fantasies assured me. I returned to Kapit for the second time, and then tried the Balwi River above Balaga. In their article, the Whittiers had indicated that this river was the major trade route from the Apo Kayan to the commercial centers of Sarawak. In the Balaga Bazaar, I bought a ridiculous amount of salt and also flashlight batteries, because I had read they were very valuable in the interior. I caught a ride on a shallow draft cargo boat, similar to a landing craft, and we left Balaga before noon. We made good time that first day and successfully powered through the treacherous Bakun Rapids before nightfall. The cargo boat was returning to Balaga the next day, and my plans were to find another boat headed upriver. I was asked where I wanted to get off, and at random I said, Ruma Bawang, the Kayan village at Long Murum. I chose this village from my limited knowledge because it appeared to be the largest village in the area. This, I reasoned, meant more people, more boats, and more upriver travel opportunities. I couldn't have selected a worse village. I was stranded there for a week, and during that time no one took any interest in me or my laughable plans. In all of Sarawak, I had never stayed in a more unpleasant village. My possessions generated a great deal of interest, and I was soon fleeced of most of them. I was charged for accommodations and meals, which is unheard of in longhouse communities, but the worst thing about my situation was that there was no independent way for me to leave. The village wasn't connected by footpath to the only nearby longhouse, Long Linau, or so I was told, and no one would take me upstream or downstream by boat. Make the best of the situation, I told myself. Practice speaking Malay. Unfortunately, everyone insisted on my teaching them English and how to do the twist to their Rolling Stones tapes. On day 8, I had literally to take the shirt off my back and give it to one of the sons of headman Lihan Hawang so that he would take me 10 minutes downriver to a government work camp. The shirt, by the way, was a gratuity, a special thank you, in addition to the quadruple rate fee for gasoline, rental of longboat, and hire charge for the driver. The round trip couldn't have taken half an hour, and I was charged for the entire day. I left that village feeling like a walking dollar sign. I wasn't angry, just confused. Seldom have I felt so totally inadequate. I was doing everything wrong. I later learned why the people in Rumah Bawang might not have been feeling particularly hospitable and friendly. At the time of my visit, those people were in conflict with the government over a bitterly contested land compensation claim. Just downriver at Bakun Gorge, a 2,400-megawatt dam was to be built. The lake formed by the dam would flood 600 square kilometers of virgin jungle, agricultural land, sacred burial sites, and prime hunting grounds. 4,000 people in 52 longhouses would be displaced, and the people of Rumah Bawang were to be among them. With construction due to commence, the people up and down the Balwi River Valley didn't know what cash compensation would be paid or where they would be resettled. The concept of the project is staggering. Sarawak's current annual electrical consumption is less than 200 megawatts. One may well ask where all the excess power is going to go. The answer? To industrial, energy-starved Singapore and peninsular Malaysia via a 650-kilometer submarine cable. Plans for construction are going ahead despite claims by German engineers on the site that the local rock may not be strong enough to hold the water pressure from the 190-foot-high cement dam. The possible benefit of a dam with an anticipated operational life estimated to be 35 to 50 years, when weighed against the complete environmental and social devastation of such a large area, is difficult to understand. Government officials claim the large reservoir will improve fishing and encourage tourism in the area. Water skiing has also been suggested by the government. The World Health Organization, commenting on waterborne and communicable diseases associated with huge dams in tropical areas, suggests that typhoid, cholera, dysentery, viral infections, schistosomiasis, opisthokaiosis.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.